It's September 13th, 2020. South Dakota's Republican Governor Kristi Noem is in Sioux Falls for the final day of a PGA Champions Tour event. What might seem routine now is a big deal at the time. It's just 6 months after the outbreak of the COVID-19 pandemic. With no end in sight, most big events around the world are canceled. Except in South Dakota, which openly declares the state open for business. That means many events are still happening, like the Sturgis Motorcycle Rally and even a fireworks display at Mount Rushmore. However, in the midst of moments like these, something happens to challenge the state's party unity, political identity, and the resolve of its public institutions. That September weekend in 2020, Governor Noem calls a last-minute press conference at the Sioux Falls City Hall and is joined by Craig Price, the Secretary of the Department of Public Safety. A handful of reporters show up. It's a Sunday.
We ready?
In 2020, Governor Noem is frequently offering news conferences to highlight the state's response to the coronavirus. Those are typically during the weekdays and at the state capitol, 2.5 hours away. This press conference is different, feels urgent.
Well, good afternoon. Last night at about 10:30 p.m. in Hyde County, the Attorney General was involved in a crash while driving on U.S. Highway 14 just west of Highmore. There was a fatality, and law enforcement is working on identifying the deceased and notifying the family.
Noem says the State Highway Patrol will run the investigation, which is standard procedure. Secretary Price will oversee it and report directly to her. Price steps up to the podium and gives a brief statement.
South Dakota Highway Patrol routinely investigates fatality crashes across our state, and we will handle this as we would any other fatal crash. If there are any questions, we would be open to any questions you might have.
Reporters pause for a moment, taking in the information. The state's attorney general is involved in a crash that killed someone. One reporter offers up a question, followed by others, and they're all met with a similar answer. Condition of the Attorney General?
As with any investigation, there's a lot of questions that we can't answer. That would be one of those questions.
How many people are involved?
We know that the Attorney General was involved. The rest of it is being investigated, and those details will come out at a later time.
Who was in the car?
And the side thing of these investigations, there's so many things that you can't comment on specific to that. There's a lot of details that are going to be being run down, as with any fatal crash that's investigated, and that information will be available at a later time.
Aspects of the crash?
There's no aspects of the crash that I can explain that happened. I can tell you that as far as the response to a fatality crash, we have officers that are responding. We have officers that are highly trained in investigating these types of incidents, and they're the ones that are working the incident.
The press conference is brief, but those few moments on that Sunday afternoon are the beginning of a case that challenges the reputation of some of the state's top leaders. I'm Lee Schrubinger, and this is SDPB's Short Walk. The impeachment of South Dakota Attorney General Jason Ravnsborg. It's a look at the arc of one political career, the events of a dark night, and the ripple effects.
Hello.
Hi.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hello.
911, this is Allie. How can I help you?
Allie, I'm the Attorney General, and I hit something. By Highmore. Highmore, and it's in the middle of the road.
Okay, give me 1 second here. Let me get you a map.
From the very beginning, the law enforcement investigation into Jason Ravnsborg's fatal crash is exhaustive. When the case finally heads through the courts and to the legislature for action, the investigative file is publicly available. It's a massive collection that contains hours of audio and video, as well as hundreds of pages of documents. It provides a glimpse into the investigation, as well as a relatively unfiltered look at a powerful politician in the spotlight. This podcast takes an unflinching look at the investigation file and subsequent response from the courts, lawmakers, and state officials in 9 episodes. There's fresh research and reporting, along with the work of my colleagues and peers who all hustled to break news covering this unprecedented case. My colleagues attend Governor Noem's press conference in Sioux Falls that Sunday in September 2020. I live on the opposite side of the state in Rapid City, 5 hours away. My journey with this story starts the following day, Monday morning, when I pick up the phone and call Nick Nemec.
Hello?
Nick Nemec lives in Hyde County. He's a farmer who spent a lifetime working the land. I call him the day after the governor's announcement. My recorder only picks up the receiving end. I ask how he's doing.
I could be better, I guess, but yeah.
It's a poor question, given the circumstances. Nick Nemec's cousin is Joe Beaver, the man who died in the Attorney General's weekend crash. Nemec is also a former state lawmaker, a Democrat, back when they still got elected in the middle of the state. So he's familiar dealing with reporters.
Well, I can kind of give you a rundown of what happened.
It seems like Nemec has already told this story 100 times, whether to others or himself, just to make sense of it all. He says on Saturday evening, his cousin Joe runs his truck into a ditch about a mile west of Highmore, a remote prairie town on the road to the state's capital. The ditches were freshly mowed. Nemec says Joe hit a round hay bale about the size of his truck.
And bent his bumper, so it was rubbing on the tire. He called my brother and asked Victor to, Victor's my brother. He called my brother Victor and asked Victor to come and get him and give him a ride back to town.
It's getting dark as Nick's brother Victor and Joe try to straighten out the bumper. They give up, leave the truck in the ditch, and Victor gives Joe a ride back to his house. They'll figure it out the next day.
And so when Victor went to Highmore on Sunday morning, here there was this accident scene where they were directing traffic around this accident scene and had the highway closed down to one lane and all this sort of thing, all kinds of cop cars.
When Victor gets to Joe's house, no one is home, and Joe isn't picking up his phone.
He got a bad feeling in his gut, given that Joe's pickup was in the ditch, you know, half mile beyond this accident site. And Joe was nowhere to be seen.
So Victor calls the county sheriff, who tells the family to wait at Joe's house. And there they wait for hours.
Highmore, and it's in the middle of the road.
Okay, give me 1 second here. Let me get you a map. Do you know where you're at?
I believe I'm by Highmore. I can see the town.
Okay.
I think that's Highmore.
East or west?
I just went through it. I am west of Highmore.
Okay.
About a mile, if that.
Okay. And this is Scott.
Say again.
And what was your name?
Jason. Ravnsborg.
Ravnsborg. Perfect. Okay.
As a politician, Jason Ravnsborg makes a name for himself attending county Republican events around the state. No Lincoln Day dinner is too far. On September 12, 2020, Ravnsborg travels to Redfield to attend the Spink County Lincoln Day dinner at a bar and grill called Roosters. Driving home that night, he hits and kills Joe Beaver. In the days that follow the crash, the Attorney General spends hours with North Dakota investigators answering questions about the incident. He describes the event.
These are usually dinners held in the spring, but because of COVID have been largely moved to the fall, and they are county party functions, and I guess it's a Republican function.
Okay.
A political function.
The dinner starts at 5. Ravnsborg shows up a little early.
So how these events usually work is they have like a silent auction. It's the party faithful come in. There's some speeches throughout the night. There's approximately 30 people there. I didn't count,
okay,
you know, per se, 20, 30 people.
Ravnsborg gives a speech, as does U.S. Senator Mike Rounds, and people take a few photos. Ravnsborg eats a steak and baked potato and washes it down with a Coke. He leaves Redfield around 9. But the 2.5-hour drive back home to Pierre changes everything. Ravnsborg listens to the end of the Minnesota Twins game. At one point, he calls his father, but the call drops around the town of Miller. About an hour into the drive, he reaches the town of Highmore and thinks about getting gas.
I looked to the left and right, and they just both looked closed, so I didn't do that. And I went through, and I saw a sign that said 65 miles an hour. So I believe I started to accelerate. And then I saw a sign that said 48 miles to Pierre. And, you know, you just kind of did one of those groans, like, oh, you still got 48 miles to go. And then, quite frankly, wham!
That moment is when Jason Ravnsborg hits something. It's a moment that will affect events for many people for years to come. The story continues after a break.
Short Walk is made possible with your Friends of SDPB membership and by the support of Explore South Dakota Fund. Corporate support for Short Walk comes from Turbeck Law Office in Watertown, attorneys handling insurance and personal injury claims. More at turbecklaw.com. For regular updates on all the news around the state, subscribe to The Morning Report, delivered twice a week to your inbox. We also produce a daily news podcast. You can find out more information about both at sdpb.org/news.
Are you injured at all, Jason?
I am not, but my car sure as hell is.
Uh-oh. Are you out of the roadway?
I am out of the roadway. I was able to get over, but...
Okay.
It sure hit and mashed my windshield.
Oh, no. Okay. Do you think it was a deer or something?
Is he vomiting?
I have no idea.
Okay.
Yeah, it could be. I mean, it was right in the roadway and...
Okay. And were you traveling westbound then?
Yes, westbound,
okay.
Back to Pierre.
Okay. Alrighty, well, I will go ahead and let the sheriff know. He's the one that's on call right now.
I'm Lee Strubinger, and this is SDPB's Short Walk, the story of a political career, a fatal crash, and the consequences. The dispatch operator takes the rest of Attorney General Jason Ravnsborg's driver's license information, and she calls the sheriff.
Good. Say, I've got a signal to car versus unknown. The driver is saying he's not sure what he hit, but it smashed his windshield and it did some pretty good damage to his vehicle. He's just west of Highmore. He can see town.
Okay.
It mapped right now, but he's going to need you. It's just a heads up. It's Jason Ravnsborg, the AG.
Okay. I will. Did you get a hold of a deputy?
You are who we have on the board.
Hyde County Sheriff Mike Volek is a longtime lawman in the middle of his sixth term in office when he gets the call about a crash near Highmore. The sheriff lives just west of the crash scene and arrives a few minutes later. In the days following the crash, investigators interview Volek. He tells them he finds Ravnsborg next to his car with his cell phone flashlight on, looking in the ditch.
All right. And what did he tell you?
That he thought he hit something.
Okay.
Which
did he say
pretty
what he,
apparent, right?
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
And I said, through here, we have deer accidents constantly.
So the two men look for their deer, but they can't find it. Ravnsborg's car is badly damaged and undrivable. It'll take a tow driver an hour to get to the crash scene and another hour to tow the car back to Pierre. It's close to 11 p.m., and not wanting to keep the Attorney General waiting, Sheriff Volek lends Ravnsborg his personal vehicle to continue the drive home. Ravnsborg leaves the scene. But something bothers Volek. Based on the damage to the car, the deer must be nearby. He returns to the scene and sees something illuminated in the grass.
You had mentioned that you saw a light glowing?
Yes.
Okay. Did you ever go check that light out?
I looked at it and it looked like a light bulb out of the car.
Uh-huh.
but I didn't go down and pick it up.
Uh-huh. Okay.
It's like, I wish I had taken a picture of it.
And it was on, though?
It was on.
Okay. Have you ever seen that before?
No.
Okay.
No.
Folick tells investigators he's about 5 feet from a light in the ditch, but his curiosity ends there, and he does not investigate it further. According to the crash investigation report, Beaver carries a flashlight as he walks along the road that evening. According to diagrams of the scene, both Folick and Ravnsborg would have walked past Beaver's body that night. To this day, Jason Ravnsborg maintains he did not see what he hit that night.
It sure hit and smashed my windshield.
Oh, no. Okay, do you think it was a deer or something? Did he vomit?
I have no idea.
Okay.
Yeah, it could be. I mean, it was right in the roadway. And...
Okay.
Jason Ravnsborg has not responded to multiple requests for an interview for this podcast. The next morning, Ravnsborg returns to the sheriff's personal vehicle. Ravnsborg's chief of staff, Tim Borman, is also there. Borman describes what happens next when he talks months later to a House impeachment committee.
He had seen some pieces of his vehicle. He wanted to stop at that scene and just look around to see if he could get an idea of what had happened the night before. I was like, that's fine. Followed him to that site. He pulled in. There was a large piece of undercarriage from the car on the shoulder of the road, and I parked a couple of car lengths or so behind. He got out of his vehicle. He started walking west. I got out of mine, started walking to the east. I was looking at glass and other bits and pieces that were along the roadway.
And that's when Ravnsborg discovers Joe Beaver's body, which has been lying along Highway 14 for roughly 10 hours.
He called my name. I turned and looked at him. He was motioning towards the ditch with one hand saying, there's a man. I went over and to where he was motioning and looked, and I saw Mr. Beaver's body in the ditch.
Here's Sheriff Folick at the scene moments later calling in the discovery.
Public safety dispatch, this is Mike.
Hey, Mike. I need a DCI agent, and I was filming over here.
Okay, and what do you got going on?
Well, I have a dead body in the ditch.
Okay.
Days later, Ravnsborg speculates with investigators about what he could have hit.
I can see how you say I should have seen him, but I didn't see him.
And I'm just doing it
I did not see him.
That's what I'm just saying. It's from a logical mm-hmm. perspective, and that's what we're talking about all along here.
Mm-hmm.
We, from a logical perspective, if you went by that,
I don't know.
Looking, I would have seen that. And we asked a number of people. So when you go looking for a deer, you know what.
I scanned into the ditch and walking back towards my car, but I did not see him.
Again, neither did Sheriff Folick, who speaks with investigators days after the crash.
Because I'm trying to picture it, and I'm thinking, would have had to walk by the body.
You had to walk by the body.
You walked by the body to get to the flashlight.
That's what I said. Why didn't I see the damn body?
Ravnsborg says he did not drink the night of the crash. Security footage, first-hand accounts, and a toxicology test taken the next day back up the claim. He tells investigators he might have been looking at his radio or the speedometer when he struck Beaver, but he's not sure which. And that begs the question, how could this happen? 22 hours after the fatal crash, Joe Beaver's family is called in to identify the body. When I talk with Beaver's cousin, Nick Nemec, the Monday after the crash, it's clear he is frustrated.
I want to know why it took him 22 hours to call the family to identify the body. I want to know why it took him 10 hours from when the family told them who the dead man was for them to call us to come and identify the body.
Nemec says even after the family tells investigators that Joe Beaver is missing, the information trickles in slowly.
We want answers, just why it's taken so long for authorities to get their ducks in a row, which is, and it sounds like that's what they're trying to do, is get their ducks in a row. And it stinks.
Normally, the Department of Criminal Investigation handles interrogations into a case like this. But that department is in the Attorney General's office, which presents an obvious and immediate conflict of interest.
How are we doing, Jay? Good? Okay.
So on the Tuesday following the crash, Governor Noem holds another press conference to announce that agents from North Dakota will conduct the investigation along with South Dakota Highway Patrol, which falls under the governor's office.
We offer every situation the same standard of investigative procedures that we would any other person, but we are adding an extra level of transparency and accountability that I think is necessary in this case.
Public Safety Secretary Price confirms the focus on transparency in getting the investigation to the public as soon as possible.
The governor has instructed the Department of Public Safety and me to release the investigative report as soon as it is complete.
It will take half a year to wrap up the investigation. It takes 18 months before the public gets access to the crash reports. One aspect of the investigation looks into Jason Ravnsborg's cell phone use during his drive from Redfield to Pierre. Investigators focus on that during multiple days of interviews.
Do you remember, were you using your phone at all for anything besides to make a couple phone calls?
Nope, the only phone calls I made were to my father, which mm-hmm. ended prior to Miller.
Yep. Okay.
I have two phones, as you know.
Mm-hmm.
One was on the passenger seat, and the other one was on my console, and I did not, use them, then.
Okay.
I do not have the phone in my hands when the crash happened. I had, my hands on the wheel and looking at the speedometer.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
According to the investigation report, cell phone data shows Ravnsborg was on his phone in some capacity for 70% of the drive before he struck the man on the side of the road. He looked at his email and checked political websites. The North Dakota investigators remind him of that.
So what would you think, though, if I told you that when they did the phone extraction, they found some internet activity on your phone around that time?
Well, I don't not use my phone, but I did not use it at the time of the crash. No.
Okay. But were you using it up to the time of the crash?
Not that I recall.
But Ravnsborg is using his state phone in the minute leading up to the crash. According to cell phone data, he looks at a right-wing website and an article about Joe Biden's family business dealings. He stops using his phone as he drives through the city limits of Highmore. Seconds later, Ravnsborg will call 911. For years, Jason Ravnsborg has tracked high-profile conservative issues, presenting them at majority Republican events across the state. That's how he lays the groundwork with folks who will help nominate him, a man who has never won an election before, to become the most powerful law enforcement official in the state.
And so it was easier for him to come in and offer a few facts that he, and some less than facts, that he gleaned off of the internet and get Republicans to nod and smile and say, yeah, wow, you're really intelligent. You ought to be in the White House, for Pete's sake.
That's next time on Short Walk. I'm Lee Strubinger. I wrote, reported, and produced this episode. Kate Smith edited the script. Josh Chilson is our news director. Kara Hetland, our director of journalism. Twyla Olson is our director of content. SDPB's executive director is Julie Overgaard. Thanks to Matt Lachois and Flower Room Records, who created the show's music. Special thanks to the South Dakota Press Corps, representing various organizations who provided dedicated coverage of this story along the way, including Stephen Groves, Christopher Vondrachik, Joe Sneeby, Austin Goss, Ariel Zients, Patrick Callahan, Abby Wargo, Joshua Heyer, Jonathan Ellis, Jackie Hendry, Seth Tupper, and Bob Mercer. Be sure to check out more at sdpb.org/shortwalk. Please rate and review the show on Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your podcasts. Join me for the next episode of Short Walk.